In this lecture, we'll discuss the conditions for reachability and controllability for LTI system. We'll specifically focus on controllability. In the forthcoming lectures, we'll establish that reachability and controllability conditions are essentially same in case of a LTI system. Okay. So, consider this LTI system where this is a real system where X is the state vector, y is the output, u is the input. So there are m inputs, y outputs, and this is nth order system. A, B, C, D are constant real matrices of appropriate size. Recall the definition of the reachability Gramian for the LTI system, which was essentially this over the interval 0 to PF. Now, this reachability Gramian, if invertible for a specific value of the final time PF, then it would be invertible for any finite value of PF. Similarly, for the controllability Gramian being this, the controllability Gramian is invertible for a given specific value of PF here, then it would be invertible for any value, finite value of PF. Okay. So, for linear systems, what we essentially have the LTI systems here, we see in forthcoming lectures that reachability implies controllability and controllability implies reachability. In fact, the conditions that help us in taking reachability and controllability are essentially going to be the same. We will discuss this in another lecture. As of now, in this lecture, we will focus primarily on the controllability conditions for linear time invariant. Okay, so henceforth, we will focus only on the controllability and the relevant condition. So, for a LTI system, we know that the controllable set C over the interval T0 TF is defined as this. It essentially means that I can express X0 as shown here, which is minus of T0 TTF e power a T0 minus tau d u tau d tau. Now, from Kelly-Hamilton theorem, I can have this matrix exponential written as a finite summation series where it is a linear combination of the powers of A ranging from 0 to n minus 1, with the coefficients being the coefficients basically being having the argument of sigma if E is raised to the power E is raised to A sigma. Okay. So, using the fact that the matrix exponential can be expressed as a finite sum series, what we will do is we will substitute this expression in the expression of x0. So, once we do this, this is what we get, and I can express the x0 as a product of the matrix formed by b, a, b, a square b till a n minus 1 b multiplied with this column matrix that we have here. Okay. So, this b, a, b, a square b n minus 1 b will have a size of n into m n, and the matrix that you have here will be of the size m n cross 1. Okay. So, we will call this matrix b a b a square b till a n minus 1 b as, or label it as qc. Okay. So, if we need our LTI system to be controllable, then it means that the controllable set has to be the entire Rn. Okay. So, now if you see here, x0 is essentially a linear combination of the columns of the matrix formed by b, a, b, a square, b till a n minus 1, b. Okay. So, if you want the controllable set to be entire Rn, then what you need is the matrix QC defined as B, A, B, X, L, B, T, A, minus 1, B. It needs to be such that its columns span the entire R. Okay. This indicates that the QC has to have n number of linearly independent columns. Right. Or the rank of QC has to be n. So, what we can see from here is that for the controllable set to be entire Rn, or the system to be controllable, we need the rank of QC which is nothing but b a b a square between a minus 1 b to b n, where n is the order of the system. Okay, so one way to check controllability for LTI systems is you form a matrix out of the A matrix and B matrix, which is given in this form. So the first entry is B, the second entry is AB, and the third entry is A square B, and you keep on doing this till AN minus 1 B. Call this matrix is called as the controllability matrix. You take the rank of this controllability matrix. If the controllability matrix rank is N, then we say the LTI system, or sometimes we say that the pair AB is controllable. Okay, so please again note that this QC matrix is also known as the controllability matrix. Okay, so this is one way to test the controllability of the linear time invariant system. We form the controllability matrix and check its rank. If it is full rank, then the LTI system is said to be controllable, or the pair AB is said to be controllable. Okay, because we are forming this matrix only out of AB. Another way in which you can test the controllability of LTI systems, and is known as the eigenvalue based controllability test. Okay, so you have this square matrix A with you. Find all the eigenvalues of A. Okay, the pair AB or the corresponding LTI system is said to be controllable if and only if the augmented matrix formed by A minus lambda I, where lambda is the eigenvalue of A, I is the identity matrix here, and the matrix B. So you form a matrix like this, A minus lambda I augmented with B. So you have a matrix now. So if and only if this augmented matrix has rank N for all the eigenvalues of A that you have formed. You don't not just evaluate at one eigenvalue, you have to check the rank at all the eigenvalues of A. If at all the eigenvalues of A, this augmented matrix has full rank, then the pair AB is controllable, or the LTI system is said to be controllable. Similarly, if we know that the pair AB is going to be controllable, or the LTI system is controllable, then this augmented matrix will always have full rank, which is N in this case, for all the eigenvalues. This is known as the Popov-Delevitch-Hotas or the PBH test for controllability. The benefit of this is it gives you an idea of which eigenvalues are controllable and which eigenvalues are uncontrollable. Another test for controllability is the eigenvector test for controllability of LTI system, and in fact the PBH test here can be derived from the condition that we get for the eigenvector test for controllability. So the pair AB is controllable if and only if there is no eigenvector of A transpose in the kernel of B transpose. So as I had said, kernel of a matrix essentially means the null space of a matrix. Okay, so you take A transpose, calculate all the eigenvalues that you can have. Okay, you'll have a set of eigenvalues. So you'll have infinite number of eigenvalues, in fact. Okay. Now, you take the matrix A transpose, calculate all its eigenvectors. Okay. In fact, it will have infinite number of eigenvectors. Okay, calculate all the eigenvectors that you can have. Now, none of the eigenvectors of A transpose, okay, will lie in the null space of B transpose. Okay, so for example, let's say that B is the eigenvector of A transpose, then B transpose V should not be zero. And this should be true for all eigenvectors of A transpose. Okay, so if this is true, then the pair AB would be controllable. So we'll see briefly the proof for the eigenvector test, and I'll leave the proof for the PBH test to you, so that you can see how it can come up from this eigenvector test itself. So see, this is if and only if condition. So what we'll start with is we'll assume that the pair AB is controllable, and we'll prove that if the pair AB is controllable, then none of the eigenvector of A transpose can be in the kernel or the null space of B transpose. Okay. So here, assume we are assuming AB is controllable. Okay, and we'll prove this by contradiction. So what we'll say is AB is controllable, and we'll also assume that there is at least one eigenvector of A that lies in the kernel or the null space of B transpose. Oh, sorry. We'll assume that AB is controllable, because that is given, and on top of it, we'll also assume that there is an eigenvector of A transpose which lies in the kernel of B transpose. That is, A transpose B will be equal to lambda V, and on top of it, B transpose V should will also be 0, and there is at least one such eigenvector V for A transpose. Okay, we'll assume this. So, assuming that both would be true, and eventually what we'll show is if AB is controllable, then this particular statement will not hold, thus implying that eigenvector of A transpose cannot be in the kernel of B transpose. Okay. So, assuming this, what we'll do is let alpha of T be the inner product of such a V that we have chosen, we have assumed to be existing, with the state vector x. So alpha is nothing but v transpose x. Take a time derivative of alpha. What we get is alpha dot to be v transpose x dot, and if you replace x dot, you have v transpose of ax plus b. Now v transpose b is 0 by assumption, so alpha dot is nothing but v transpose ax. Now v being the eigenvector of A transpose corresponding to some eigenvalue lambda. So, V transpose A is nothing but lambda V transpose. So, if we replace this, what we essentially get is alpha dot is nothing but equal to lambda, which is scalar, multiplied by alpha. The solution to this equation is alpha T being e power lambda T minus T0 alpha T0, where alpha T0 is the initial value of alpha t equal to t0. Now notice, if alpha t0 is not 0, then alpha tf cannot be 0 for any finite tf. Okay. So at t equal to tf, alpha tf cannot be 0 if tf is a finite value. This means what? If alpha tf cannot be 0, and on top of it v transpose, V is eigenvector, so V cannot be 0. So that means XTF cannot be 0. Right? If alpha TF cannot be 0, V transpose is already not 0, so XTF cannot be 0. Okay, for any finite TF that you can find out. Now, if you recall the definition of controllability, what it says is if you start from an initial XT0, okay, then there will exist some control input so that you actually come to 0 at finite tf. But what we are seeing here is you cannot come to 0 with finite at any finite, cannot cross the origin or 0 at any finite tf because of the existence of an eigenvector of A transpose in the kernel of B transpose, which means AB cannot be controllable. But our assumption was AB is controllable, so this is kind of a contradiction to our assumption. So, what we essentially establish is AB is controllable implies that none of the eigenvector of A transpose can lie in the kernel or the null space of B transpose. Now, we have to prove the other way around. So, what we have to prove is if no eigenvector of A transpose are in the kernel of B transpose, then the pair AB is controllable. Now to prove this, we can also prove that if AB is not controllable, then there exists at least one eigenvector of A transpose in the kernel of B transpose. Okay, which is essentially same as saying that there exists a V such that A transpose V is equal to lambda V and B transpose V is equal to 0. Okay. Now, we know that if AB is not controllable, then the rank of QC is going to be less than N. And the rank of QC and the rank of the transpose of QC are going to be the same. So, the rank of QC transpose is also less than N. Okay. Now, for a vector V, for some vector V to belong to the kernel of QC transpose, QC transpose V has to be 0. Okay. So, let us assume that there is a V which lies in the kernel of QC transpose. So, QC transpose V is nothing but B transpose V, B transpose A transpose V and so on, and this will be 0. Okay. Now, what happens when QC transpose acts on a vector given by A transpose? If QC transpose acts on a vector given by A transpose B, then essentially what we have is a vector where everything is 0 except for the last part, which is B transpose multiplied by A transpose raised to N equal to N to V. Now, A transpose N can be expressed as a linear combination of identity A transpose square till A transpose to the power n minus 1. Now, if we substitute this linear combination, what we will essentially end up with is a zero vector. Okay. So, if V is a vector in the kernel of QC transpose, then it looks like A transpose V is also a vector in the kernel of QC transpose. Okay. So, this means what? That the kernel of QC transpose is essentially invariant under the action of A transpose. Okay. So, now what we have shown is if you start with a vector in the kernel of QC transpose, then under the action of A transpose, the vector is going to lie back in the kernel of QC transpose. Thus, QC transpose kernel, the kernel of QC transpose is invariant under the action of A transpose. Now, why do you need this? Okay. This will become as we proceed further. Now, let the basis of this QC transpose be consisting of M linearly independent vectors. Okay. Why is this possible? Because the rank of QC transpose is less than N. Okay. And so, let us assume that the rank of QC transpose is nothing but M, which is less than N. So there are M number of linearly independent vectors that form the basis of QC transpose. Now, when A transpose acts on these basis vectors eta 1 till eta m, what we essentially get is something of this form. So, this is what we had seen when we were seeing the action of linear transform on vectors during the linear algebra model. So this is what happens. Okay. So, let us represent this matrix that we get of scalars by a matrix m. Okay. So essentially, this is what? This is the representation, matrix representation of A transpose with respect to the basis eta 1 to eta n. Okay. Rather, we should not say that. Now, here M is a M cross M matrix, the capital M matrix is M cross M real matrix. Suppose W is a eigenvalue, W is a eigenvector of M that corresponds to the eigenvalue lambda. Okay. Suppose there is an eigenvalue lambda of M, and suppose W is a corresponding eigenvector. Okay. Now, A transpose is capital gamma W, where gamma is essentially the matrix formed by the basis vectors eta 1 to eta M. Okay. This is same as gamma M W. Why? Because A transpose gamma, as you can see from upstairs, A transpose gamma is nothing but gamma multiplied by M. So, A transpose gamma is replaced by gamma M, and then you have gamma M W. Now, M W is nothing but lambda W, because W is the eigenvector of M corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Given this, what I can write is this is nothing but lambda times gamma W. So, what you have here is A transpose acts on a vector gamma W and gives you a vector which is a scaled version of gamma w. That indicates that lambda has to be an eigenvalue of A transpose, and the corresponding eigenvector is gamma w. Okay, and this gamma w, as we have seen, is belonging to the kernel of QC transpose. Why? Because gamma w is nothing but a linear combination of the basis vectors of QC transpose. Okay, so what we have now is we have a vector from the kernel of QC transpose, which is also a eigenvector of A transpose corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Okay, this is what we have. Now, so this means what? So there exists a vector which is essentially gamma w in this case, which is non-zero. It satisfies that it is an eigenvector of A corresponding to some eigenvector of A transpose corresponding to some eigenvalue lambda. And in addition to that, you have B transpose V to be equal to 0. Now you can ask where this B transpose V equal to 0 came up. So if you notice, gamma w is in the kernel of QC transpose, and I am representing gamma w by V now. So V is in the kernel of QC transpose. Okay, so that means QC transpose V is going to be 0, which means B transpose V is going to be 0. So this is essentially coming from here. Any vector in the QC transpose, you have the B transpose V component also to be 0. So what you have is there is an eigenvector of A transpose in the kernel of B transpose. Okay, so what we started with was AB is not controllable, and we finally ended up saying that there is at least one eigenvector such that eigenvector of A transpose such that it lies in the kernel of B transpose. This is what we show. Okay, which essentially means that no eigenvector of A transpose, if there is no eigenvector of A transpose in the kernel of B transpose, then the pair AB has to be controllable. So we have shown both the directions, and hence we end up with the condition that we have got under the eigenvector test for controllability, that the pair AB is controllable if and only none of the eigenvectors of A transpose lie in the kernel of B transpose. So what I suggest is you use this condition and try to establish the condition that we have got for the PBH test. Okay, another way of writing this right hand side of the implication is basically meaning that the vector that satisfies the condition of this is only the zero vector. Okay, means there is no such eigenvector. Okay, so use this test to establish the PBH test. Now this is some important result that we get. So what controllability actually implies? So assume that you have this LTI system whose state equation is just given. I'm not talking about the output equation either. Now assume that this linear time invariant system is controllable, or the pair AB is controllable. Okay. Now suppose someone gives you a set of complex numbers. There are n such complex numbers. Okay, a set of numbers taken up from the set of complex numbers. Okay, n such complex numbers, and if the numbers are complex, then you essentially, and when I say complex, it also includes real numbers. Okay, because real numbers are set of complex. Now, if any of this number given to you is complex, then it is ensured that the set also has a conjugate of the complex number. Okay, that's the only concern. So if this is true, if the system is controllable, so given any set of such n number of numbers taken from the complex set with the assurance that complex numbers if in the set occur in conjugate pair, then you will always be able to find a matrix, let us label that matrix as K, such that if you substitute U as minus kx this is the feedback. Okay, so I am taking the state and using it as a feedback. I am replacing U with minus K. Okay, then the closed loop system that we get once we replace U equal to minus K. So the new system, the closed loop system is what now? It is X dot equal to A minus BK multiplied by X. So this system will have all its eigenvalues equal to the eigenvalues that have been given. What this is trying to say is that where AB is controllable, or the LTI system is controllable, if you give me any pair of any set of eigenvalues, any n set of eigenvalues, okay, or any set of eigenvalues that has n. So what is this? What this is trying to tell me is, if I have a LTI system which is controllable, okay, and if someone gives me a set of numbers taken from the complex set, and with the fact that if there are any complex numbers in the set, then they occur in conjugate pairs, then I can find a matrix, let us call this matrix as the gain matrix K, such that A minus BK will have all its eigenvalues equal to the set of numbers that has been given. Okay, so now this is a powerful result, because if the system is controllable, then what we can ensure is something known as asymptotic stability of a system by closing the loop. So the closed loop system can be made asymptotically stable. We'll discuss more on this when we discuss internal stability, and this part will come into play, or we'll see how this is important when we start designing state feedback controllers. So we'll stop here. Thank you.